very good morning, students. Today we are going to start with the introduction of the syllabus for the subject zoology for BSc second year medical students. In this semester, it is the third semester, we are going to study two papers, the chordate 1 and chordates 2 in evolution. In chordates 1, there will be two sections. In the first section, we will study about the general characteristics of the chordates, the kinoderm theory, about the type specimen Hermannia, Amphioxus, and Cyclostomata petromyza. In section B, we will study about fishes and amphibians, the parental care in them, the different types of scales in fishes, and the migration in fishes. These all will be studied in paper 1, that is chordates 1, and the classification will also be studied along with these. In paper 2, the chordates 2 and evolution, the section A comprises of the study of amphibians, the study of the reptiles, in which we will study the Uromastrix, and along with it we will study the pigeons, the poisonous and the non-poisonous snakes, the flight adaptations in the pigeons. And in the second section we will study about the mammalians, the dentition in mammals, the different organ systems in the mammals. And the second part of this paper comprises of the evolution, in which we will study about the various theories of evolution, the homologous analogous organs, the evidences of evolution, and a little bit about the types of evolution, the microevolution, megaevolution, macroevolution. So these are the two papers which we are going to study in this semester. We will first start with the chordates 1. In this chordates, both the paper will, two theory paper will be conducted for these two papers of 35 marks each. And the practical for both these papers will be taken collectively of 50 marks. So we will start with the chordates 1. Chordates is basically derived from the word chordae, which means string or cord, and atta means bearing. So they are the cord-bearing animals. They have three fundamental characteristics, which is the presence of notochord, the tubular nerve cord, and the pharyngeal gill slits. The chordata is the most important phylum of the animal kingdom, and it is the most vast phylum of the animal kingdom. It inhabited most of the places. It is very dominant. The animals of this phylum are dominant on the surface of Earth and come second in accordance with the arthropodas and molluscas. The chordata is divided into two subphylum, which are vertebrata or craniata, and protochordata or craniata. In vertebrata, we will study fishes, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals. In protochordata, there are tunicates, lancelets, and acorn worms. The three fundamental characteristics of the chordates are, these three fundamental characteristics basically occur in their early embryonic life, and they are mostly modified or lost in adults, except in brachiostoma, in which they are retained even in the adult's life. So first feature is the pharynx. The pharynx is basically the interior part of the digestive canal, and it acquires complications in their structure in all the chordates. The complication is because of due to a series of lateral symmetrical outgrowths which arises from the pharynx, and these symmetrical outgrowths are referred to as the gill pouches. These gill pouches open outside through the clefts, which are referred to as the gill clefts or the gill slits or the brachial clefts. These brachial clefts appear during the development of all the chordates. The gill slits are functional in the adults in protochordates and lower aquatic vertebrates, where they are necessary for the respiration process. However, in the chordates, they are lost because in them the higher vertebrates, the respiration in adults is pulmonary, so gill slits disappear. In protochondrates, the gill slits also has the secondary function of bringing the food along with the water to the pharynx. So this is the this diagram shows the three fundamental chordate characters, which is the dorsal hollow nerve cord, the notochord, and the pharyngeal gill slits. So this was about the pharynx, the first fundamental character. Then comes the notochord. Notochord is basically a rod of the vacuolated cells. It contains a gelatinous matrix which is surrounded on outer side by the fibrous and the inner side by the elastic notochordal sheath. This is the notochord. It is derived from the endoderm cells which are present in the roof of the archenteron of the embryo, the stage which comes during the development of the embryo. It is present below the nerve cord. In brachiostoma, it persists throughout the life. In adult vertebrates, it is partially or completely replaced by the vertebral column. In these animals, the notochord is found to run through the vertebrae, but it gradually diminishes and it remains as only a series of disconnected thickenings of the intervertebral disc. Lastly, the last characteristic is the presence of the nerve cord. The tubular central nervous system occurs in all vertebrates in the form of longitudinal hollow nerve cord. It is dorsal in position. It is ectodermal in a region. It arises from the ectodermal cells of the embryonic neural plate. The nerve cord encloses a cavity which is referred to as the neurocoele or neural canal. In vertebrates, it is enlarged in the region of the head, forming the brain or the cerebral vesicle. This is enclosed in a protective cage which is called as the cranium. The posterior part constitutes the spinal cord which runs through the vertebral column. The central nervous system is there so as to integrate and coordinate all the body activities. So these were the three fundamental characteristics of a chordates, that is the presence of the pharyngeal gill slits, the notochord, and the tubular nerve cord. There are some characteristics which are other characteristics which are present in the higher chordates. These are first the heart. Heart is ventral in position and the flow of the blood is usually from the interior to the posterior side. It is enclosed in a very peculiar cavity which is called as the pericardial cavity and the wall of which is referred to as the pericardium. In non-chordates, the heart is modified dorsal vessel and therefore it is dorsal in position. However, in higher chordates, it is ventral in position. Secondly, the second characteristic is the mouth. In invertebrates, the brain is present more or less above the mouth. Initial posterior part of the gut is surrounded by the circumoral ring of the nervous material. But in vertebrates, such kind of any ring is lacking and the nervous system is on one side of the body and is dorsal to the mouth. The limbs. There are two pairs of limbs. They are basically the lateral extensions of the body and they have internal skeleton for the support and this is also there so as to provide the attachment to the muscles. Then the tail. The posterior part of the body forms post-anal metamerically segmented tail in case of higher vertebrates, which differs markedly from the unsegmented condition of the terminal part of the invertebrate body. The tail is extremely flexible and muscular, and in aquatic forms, it is the main propulsive organ. It is modified in the terrestrial forms and in vestigial and is vestigial in the adults. Then the gut. The digestive tract is divided into stomach with gastric glands and the intestine. They also have the mesentery. They have the mesentery, which helps in suspending these stomach and intestine to the dorsal wall of the abdomen. The position of the liver, its development as special diverticulum of the gut, and its associated veins are equally distinctive in case of quadrants. Hypophysis. Hypophysis is the interior lobe of the pituitary body. It develops as an outgrowth from the cavity of the mouth of the embryo. Early in development, it becomes entirely separated from the cavity of the embryo and forms a closed vesicle. Now, the characters which are common to the chondrates and the higher non-chondrates. First is exudation. Both the chondrates and the higher non-chondrates have distinct polar axes. There is the interior region which is referred to as the cephalic region or the head, and there is the posterior region which is referred to as the tail or caudal region. The longitudinal axis from the head to tail or from cephalic to caudal region is called the anterior posterior axis. Then the bilateral symmetry. Both the chondrates and the higher non-chondrates have bilateral symmetry. That means that whenever their body is cut, their body can be cut down into two equal halves only, that is the right and the left equivalent parts. That means both of these, the annelids and arthropods, the higher non-chondrates and the chondrates, have the bilateral symmetry. Then the surfaces and the directions of body. There are the body, if with the presence of the bilateral symmetry, the animals usually develop the habit of keeping one particular side of the body either in contact with the substratum or facing downward. The surface which is facing downward is referred to as the ventral surface, and the upper surface is referred to as the dorsal surface. The forward end is called the anterior side, and the opposite end as the posterior side, and the sides are referred to as the lateral sides. The point of attachment of a structure to the body is called the proximal end, and the free end as distal end. The direction towards a head is referred to as cephalic and towards the tail as caudal. Then planes. Whenever the body is cut into mid-longitudinal axis, that section is called the sagittal section. When it is cut, the section is made vertical plane, which is parallel with the longitudinal axis, it is called longitudinal section or LS. But when sections are made on vertical plane at right angles to the longitudinal section, it is called as transverse section. And when the section is done in horizontal plane, it is called as horizontal or frontal section. Then comes the metamerism. Metamerism is a very basic characterization of the arthropoda and annelids, which have the segments. These, in arthropods and annelids, the segmentation is both internal and external, and each segment is referred to as the metamere, somite, or segment. They are basically the linear series of similar segments. In chondrates, the segmentation is externally less clear. In vertebrates, there is no external segmentation. Vertebrates show the segmentation in embryonic development, and later on, it is only confined to the muscular, nervous, and skeletal system. Cephalization. The segments of the interior end form head to become more and more distinctly separated from the rest of the body. And it is also there so as to localize the nervous system, that is brain and the sense organs. The head becomes more dominant part of the body. This localization of the nervous system in the head, along with the dominance of the head, is referred to as cephalization. Higher is the degree of cephalization, greater is the number of segments composing the head. Then the cilom. Cilom or body cavity is the cavity between the body wall and the alimentary canal, and a true cilom is lined by the mesoderm. It is present in higher non-quadrates and quadrates, and the mode of the origin is different in different group of animals. In Annelida and Arthropoda, Mollusca and higher quadrates, the mode of origin is cysocelous. That is, it is formed by the splitting of the mesodermal bands originating from the blastopore region. But in Echinodermata and Protoquadrata, the mode of origin is anteriocelous. That is, they develop by the fusion and the expansion of a number of pouches splitting off from the roof of Archenteron. Then all the higher non-quadrates and quadrates are triploblastic, that is, above the level of Coelentrata, all the animals are triploblastic. They are formed of three germ layers, ectoderm, endoderm and mesoderm. Organization. All the animals from phylum Nemertina have organ grade of organization. These organ forms different organ systems which are more developed in vertebrates than in invertebrates, and they are made up of to perform several functions of digestion, circulation, respiration, excretion. They perform different functions. There is more of the specialization. So these were the different characteristics which were similar between the higher quadrates and between the quadrates and the higher non-quadrates. So now, what was the ancestry of this quadrate? How these quadrates have evolved from the non-quadrates? Various theories was proposed according to this. First of all, it was believed that the quadrates have arisen from the Coelentrata by the independent development of the different specializations. However, this is not correct. Secondly, the annelid theory was put forward because of the similarities, but there were many differences between the annelids and the quadrates' early embryonic development. Therefore, it is also being not considered. The most accepted theory is the echinoderm theory. Basically, if we see the echinoderm adults and the quadrates, there is no similarity. No typical quadrate characters are found among the radially symmetrical animals. They have no internal skeleton and have too many peculiar and complicated organs of their own. But their early embryos are free swimming, they are tiny, they are free swimming, and they float freely in water. They show the bilateral symmetry, similar to those which are found in the quadrates. That means the adults of these echinoderms, which have the radial symmetry, is the secondary affair, and this is the primary affair. Therefore, it can be considered that the quadrates have arisen from the echinoderms. And this larva of echinoderm resembles the tornadian larva of balanoglossus. This figure shows the protoquadrate might have derived from the echinoderm larva. So this is the echinoderm larva and these are the protoquadrate's larva. Their similarity shows that these may have arisen from the echinoderm larva. So the similarities between these larvae proves that they have arisen from the echinoderm larva. So there are some embryological evidences which are the anterior cilox cilom in both the echinoderm and the quadrates, presence of mesoderm and deuterostomous mouth. The central nervous system develops from the dorsal strip of ectoderm. Serologically, there is similarity between the proteins of the body fluids of quadrates and echinoderm. These evidences strongly suggest that some type of small bilaterally symmetrical animal of very simple structure possessing many features of larval echinoderm or a cornworm but lacking the specialization of either vertebrae group or echinoderm has resulted in the evolution of the quadrates. And from these simple organisms or animals arise the more specialized organisms. They developed specialized breathing organs in the form of gill slits, better possibility of mobility, powerful musculature, notochord, and a better nervous system for activity development. So the chordates appears to be arise, the chordates appears to arise from the these echinoderm. And after the development of the chordates, finally the vertebrates appeared. So the various characteristics of phylum Chordata are: they can be aquatic, they can be terrestrial, they can be aerial. All are free living, no fully parasitic forms known. They are small to large in size, they have bilateral symmetry, they are metamerically segmented, they are triploblastic, there is presence of true coelom. Exoskeleton is well developed in most of the vertebrates. Notochord is present at some stage of development. They persist in some cases. Endoskeleton is cartilaginous in some and it is bony in others. Pharyngeal gill slits are present at some stage of development, may persist in others, but disappears in vertebrates with pulmonary respiration. Digestive system is a complete tube with digestive glands. Circulatory system is closed with ventral heart and well-developed hepatic portal system. Central nervous system is dorsal and hollow. The anterior end is enlarged to form a brain. Excretory system consists of proto-meso or metanephric kidneys. Sexes are generally separate with rare exceptions. Thank you.